My name is James Colclough. I'm technically a GIS specialist that has entered the BIM world, and I lead BIM for transportation in Europe for AECOM. My presentation today is about integrating BIM and asset management and GIS for asset management. I was a little bit disappointed yesterday. Relevant now because we're so large through the merging of AURS and AECOM into one organisation, 700,000 employees. So I hope that from that perspective, bring together some thoughts on how we can how we move an industry forward and an organisation like AECOM forward and not just a specialist. I'd also thought that GIS and BIM share something in common. It's the information, and that's the bit I'm going to focus on today. So I want to talk about key challenges, that flow of information through the asset lifecycle, and where we go next. I saw this image and I thought that was quite a challenge. I'm not sure I'd like to be a BIM manager with that particular project, but I also want to pose a question. We've been talking around GeoBIM about GIS plus BIM, and I was corrected a few months back by saying it was GIS and BIM. But really, is GIS, does that equal BIM? And for the end user, is it not the same thing as the information? Certainly, when we had some technical discussions this morning, and they sit as two discrete entities when you look at data at the moment, and particularly with scale as well in terms of the use of the data when we're talking around keeping those separate to a certain degree and interacting where required. Well, I quite like this building smart pyramid because I've had a lot of people in AECOM that got into use of BIM and saying, well, BIM isn't that just 3D modelling, we've done that before, what's different, why do we need to be doing this? And really that sits at the top. What is the foundation of that information? So as an organisation, you've got to do something, you've got to do something different. You just can't keep soldiering on, following the person in front. The time which that engineer that's been doing the same thing for 30 years and become uncomfortable has now got to embrace change, and that's the difficult aspect. So it's really about collaborating and communicating between teams. I think this was my our marketing attempt to try and put together an image of what BIM is, but I've changed it around this to say, is this BIM? Because it's about collaboration, but it's also about communication. Linking teams, engaging teams. How do we do that? On projects, that means the use of a common data environment, which I've seen or heard, but that's really fundamental in terms of the core aspect of the project delivery. So the flow of information. At the moment, we've got a lot of CAD designers that see BIM as them implementing their BIM tools, and that's a danger to us because there's an element of missing what goes before and then what comes after. From Turkish Highways project, it was all GIS in terms of what data we collected, and that information would then get used through the asset management cycle. For aviation, it's a really interesting area because they're sort of a mini city, aren't they? And building information, whether it be 2D or 3D, can be collected and used in a portal, a map portal. And work we've done with NICE solutions in terms of bringing together GIS space information in a map portal that an enterprise can use, i.e., everybody, around safety and security. Being one application, but there's multiple airports. This one's paper management, but I could go through about 100 slides in terms of operational data uses. It's not just that for airports, it's also during the design and build phase, and that's through some of the benefits we've been discussing on faster pace of construction, cheaper costs, etc. How are we utilising that data? So we have an normalised data hub which feeds the design tools and the particular process there and interacts with 4D data, 5D data. But the important thing here is that the other side of the picture is the operational systems that are in place and how that data flows into them. So it's really merging the two, well, the flow of information from the different stages of asset lifecycle, but also the merging of the bases. So where can we start in that process? As building smart slide suggested, we start with the data, and that's what we have done. So we tend to go into organisations and assess what information they've got, what information do they need to collect and standardise, how we can hold that in a system to enable people to access it. In the final aspect, which is a GIS-based portal, because that's easy for people to access and understand it. That's just a more complicated diagram of that, but it just shows the linkages that have been put in place to enable that process to work across an airport. Normalised data hub linking with the GIS spatial data set, and also the Maximo facilities management database. Finally, in railways, we worked with the HS2. This is going to be a new station in my home city of Birmingham in the UK. And for them, BIM is fundamental in terms of managing information. But what does that mean? It means BIM for design, but it also means utilising a large amount of spatial, geospatial data that we've already got during the planning phase and the conceptual design phase. So over the last few years, we've been working on a second phase of the project, which involved converting our data from CAD to GIS, which I'm trying to get away from that conversion process. So where next? Well, we would like to achieve some of the cost savings that are at the moment, and it's something that we're working hard at AECOM to achieve, but also record that data to ensure that we've got a story to tell as well. In terms of integrating GIS and BIM, that's a technical discussion, but it's also about teams. And so we've got three key principles in place: process, people, and technology. Put the right processes in place, and we can tell the people what to follow. They can adopt the right tools at the right time. So a large part of my work in terms of leading BIM is around organizational change. It's not just speaking to the specialists, it's about how we can take forward the whole organisation forward together. Unless we do that, we're going to get behind. And so there's a big training requirement and educational requirement in doing so. Part of that role is fostering collaboration. So how can a CAD team work with the JS team? Where does BIM fit into that? Who are the BIM specialists? And really, there's an industry push and pull on this. So we've got our clients saying, we want you to deliver BIM level 2. Some may know what that is, others don't. So there's a two-way engagement process. hopefully those standards will assist us in achieving that process, and I'll talk to you more about that. But in terms of the sort of final message,